The iron hypothesis has been around, surprisingly, since the 1930s. And in the 1930s, a British Antarctic oceanographer called John Hart, he went to the Southern Ocean and he was very puzzled because he noticed that when they measured the amount of plant nutrients in the Southern Ocean, there was nitrate to burn. There was lots of nutrients, nitrate, phosphate, but yet there was very little productivity. And he called this the paradox of Antarctica. With all of these plant nutrients, he surmised this should be a paradise for phytoplankton. They should be blooming everywhere, but yet they weren't. They were only blooming in certain parts of the ocean. And in the ensuing years, because iron is present at vanishingly low levels in seawater, less than parts per billion, so it's very difficult to measure, particularly if you're on a metal ship, as you can imagine. So it wasn't until probably in the last 25 years when people actually went down there and made some measurements of the iron concentrations in the surface waters of Antarctica, and lo and behold, they found they were very, very low. And this revived interest in this paradox of the phytoplankton, which then was developed into the iron hypothesis. And that was that in the Southern Ocean and in a couple of other regions of the ocean, one being the Gulf of Alaska and in the North Pacific, the phytoplankton are anemic. Their growth, their productivity is limited by iron supply. And this results in this paradox where we have high nutrient but low chlorophyll. So we've got lots of plant fertilizer, but very low stocks of phytoplankton. And of course, there were also some climatic implications of this. We know from these ice core records that in the deep distant past, thousands and hundreds of thousands of years ago, we had much higher amounts of iron coming into the ocean, particularly from desert dust. And at the same time, we observed a very pronounced decrease in the amount of atmospheric carbon dioxide. It was almost one third lower during these periods of high iron. And this led a very famous oceanographer from the US called John Martin to put forward the iron hypothesis, which proposed that phytoplankton are anemic in these regions. That's why we have all of these nutrients. And if these other nutrients could be removed from the ocean, it would fuel more productivity. More of that carbon would sink into the deep ocean, drawing down more atmospheric carbon dioxide with it. And so he proposed to test that. And indeed, it was tested in the Southern Ocean. And I'm pleased to say it was tested first by a team from New Zealand on board the NIWA vessel Tangaroa. We took an international team down there and actually conducted one of the largest experiments that's been conducted in the ocean, so large that you could see it from satellite, which doesn't happen very often. It was probably around about 1,000 square kilometers in size. And what we did was to test the iron hypothesis in the Southern Ocean was we mixed up a solution of an iron salt with seawater, and then we added it to the Southern Ocean and we tracked it with another chemical tracer, because iron is, when we added it, would be taken up very quickly by the plankton and we couldn't follow it. And so we had the ship down there for a 14-day experiment. We lost our little fertilized patch of water when we had 10-meter seas, and we luckily found it the next day, and we did a 14-day experiment. And you could see very clearly from satellite that the surrounding waters had very low productivity. The area where we had purposely added the iron had very high productivity, and so that was the first confirmation of the iron hypothesis in the Southern Ocean. So we were actually able to use some of the data we collected to then investigate the feasibility of geoengineering the Southern Ocean to suck up a large amount of atmospheric carbon dioxide. Although the bloom that we were able to stimulate by adding iron to the ocean, although it sucked up some atmospheric carbon dioxide, not so much of that carbon actually sank down into the deep ocean. That was the first drawback. The second drawback was that as the bloom was being decomposed by tiny bacteria, as they were breaking down this organic material, other gases were being released, and some of these gases have even more greenhouse warming potential than carbon dioxide. So it really turned into a zero-sum game. We added the iron, we had the phytoplankton bloom, we drew some carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere, but at the same time we also released some potent greenhouse gases like nitrous oxide and methane, and therefore there was no net gain with respect to mitigating sort of the climate change issue.